Father's Day. We're going to sing first verse, Father, I adore you. Good song to begin with. Three verses, we'll sing all three about the Trinity. Here we go.
Father, I adore you.
What I have heard in this song is repeated in my heart and in my mind is, don't tell me, show me. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Brother Mike, you open us in a word of prayer.
Our Father, we thank you for all your many blessings. We thank you for this very special day. Father, I thank you for each person who's assembled here in our presence. And Holy Spirit, we just give this time to you. Come and you move in our midst. Lord, we pray that everything we do would be worship of Jesus Christ. But Father, just be with us now. We ask it all in His name. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. We're going to sing another song. And I have to tell you, though, yesterday, Banks, which is Katie's youngest, was spent a lot more of the day with us than Graham got to. They went to the house, and so, but Banks was here and he was singing, and Banks just turned 6 in April, and he was asking about the relationship between God the Son and God the Father, and he understood that they were the same and they were different. And so, I'm telling you, so here's my question. I was saying that, I mean, he's 6, and he wants to know more about how they are different and how they are the same. And so my question was this. This is your house, is the question that I'm going to ask. This is your house. Whose house is it?
God's house.
God's house. And there's another name. Whose house is it? It's Jesus' house. Are they the same?
Yeah.
Are they different?
Uh-huh.
No. Are they different?
Yeah.
Yes. Can we figure it out? No, but do we believe it?
Yes,
we do. Stay seated, but sing with us.
Together.
I knew we had talked about Father the Son, Father God, and Father the Son. And then I realized right as we got into the song, like the fifth word is talking about the Holy Spirit. And there are three, amen. Do we understand it all? No, that is a deep, deep dive. But I'm going to spend the rest of my life trying to figure it out. So I talked about two, and then we dove in with the third. And so God's good, amen? Amen. So I realized right there, you know, we talked about the new interface with some of our music and how I printed off some stuff that I didn't give to you. And then anyway, it's going to be fine. All right, so for the past 2 weeks, I know. I talk too fast and it never makes sense, not even to myself and that strangers. So for the 2 weeks, not counting last week, we started with Memorial Day weekend, and I've been stuck like a skipping record. You see, kids, records used to be, so on the Battle Hymn of the Republic, and we introduced some new verses, and I just got to visit this one more time, and so... sigh if you must, but I'm not quite ready to leave it yet. And so I just want you to know that we're going to sing a couple of verses that are in our hymnals, and then we're going to sing the chorus. And then we're going to sing three verses that are new that we did a couple of weeks ago, and then we're going to sing the chorus again. But in one of the verses that we're going to sing in a few minutes, it talks about, as for him... they wield, W-I-E-L-D, the sword. And so, you know, the Bible talks about the sword a lot. And so let me just, and I know you're familiar, if you're a believer, hopefully you're familiar, with Hebrews 4:12 that says, for the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any two-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit. And I always think of the soul as my emotions and my will, and then the spirit as that which comes alive when I accept, when I believe what God has told me, when I accept salvation and Christ's offer to me, and then that word, when that word becomes alive, and then that word begins to divide what I want from what God wants for me, all right? So that's what the word does. Wield the sword, all right? And then I think about Ephesians 6:17. I think about January Bible study when Brother Matt Pitts was here and he went through the whole book of Ephesians, every verse. And I think about Ephesians 6:17 that talks about the armor of God, and it says to tell us when we take on the entire armor of God, it says to take the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of who? The word of God. So, when we talk about wielding the sword, I'm not talking about cutting people up and cutting people down. What have we learned that is the most important thing when we carry the word of God? What do our t-shirts say? Brother Troy, can you show me our t-shirt logo that we wear so proudly? What does it say at the bottom there? Love who? And what does it say under that? What's the thing we got to have most of all? Love. What is it? Love. Say it one more time. Love. That's what we're wielding when we're wielding the word of God. Has he talked enough? Yeah. We're going to sing, "Mine eyes have seen the glory and the beauty of the lilies." Chorus. Not too fast, baby girl. Here we go. Christ was born across the sea with the glory. child and son, we want to slow down just a little bit. I do not want to miss these words, okay?
My eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. It is flowing through the cities, and the waste will be restored by the leading of the Spirit and their trusting in His word. His army marches on.
Arise,
arise and shine, my people. See the glory of the Lord as the church with signs and wonders marches on in one accord. His soldiers do not falter, as for Him they will the sword. His army.
Should we ever put our love for country ahead of our love for God? Amen? You know who did that? Hitler! Maybe I went too far with that, Brother Tim. I don't know. I'm telling you. Sorry. We serve a good, good Father. What a pattern. I had a good father here on earth. Not everyone did, but we all have one in heaven. Amen? And that word, that sword, is there for us all. Sing with me, please. We do this once a year. Probably not enough. Sing with us.
That your leaves.
Attention more than you. Father, we call them everything but that. But Lord, anything that has us in front of you, beside you, behind you, Father, that we turn loose of it and that we focus on you alone. Lord, mercy. May we look and focus on the narrow road. And thank you, Father, that as often as we wander, that Father, you are ready to redeem. If we'll just repent. In the name of Jesus, amen. So, I never know about Father's Day, but this is a Christmas song, and it's about Joseph. And I just thought it was fitting. Man, if I could raise my children, probably with the heart that Joseph raised Jesus, knowing before was God in the flesh.
Baby in my arms.
Beginning with verse 1, and I want to share a message with you this morning entitled The Role of a Father. Joshua 24, beginning with verse 1, stand with me in reverence to God. It says, and Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel, the sheep, and called for the elders of Israel, and for their heads, and for their judges, and for their officers. And they presented themselves before God, and Joshua said unto all the people, thus saith the Lord God of Israel, your fathers dwelt on the other side of the flood in old time, even Terah, the father of Abraham, the father of Nahor, and they served other gods. Verse 13, the Lord said, I've given you a land for which you did not labor, and cities which you built not, and you dwell in them, of vineyards and olive yards which you planted not, do you eat. Now therefore fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in truth. Put away the gods your father served on the other side of the flood and in Egypt, and serve ye the Lord. And if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, then choose you this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your father served that were on the other side of the flood, or the God of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. You may be seated. Bow with me. Father, we do thank you for this very special time. Lord, I pray that you would bless it. Father, just speak to our hearts. We love you. We praise you. We ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, as you know, today is Father's Day. And so as we come to this time in God's Word, I want us to think about fathers in this modern American society. You know, it's said that in more than 40% of families in America, there's no father present. But what's sad is that in the 60% where fathers are present, they have no idea of what their God-given role is. You know, it was Barbara Bush, president's wife, President George Herbert Walker Bush's wife, who said, success does not depend upon what happens in the White House, but what happens in your house. And it goes without saying that there's a great need for godly fathers today. It's been rightly said that a child is not likely to find a father in God until they find a part of God in their father. Sunday school teacher had asked her little preschool class one morning to draw a picture of God, and when the children finished their work, they were excited to show her. And some of the children drew pictures of clouds and rainbows and big hands coming out of the sky, but one little girl, when she showed her work, it was obvious that she had painted a picture of a man with a tie on. And the little girl looked at her teacher and said, "I don't know what God looks like, so I just drew my daddy instead." What a wonderful thing if all children could think of their fathers in that light, as a representative of God, as a man who knew what his God-given role was. And this morning I want us to examine the life of a man who clearly understood and carried out the God-given role that was his, a tremendous man of God by the name of Joshua. And no doubt you've heard many great messages preached from this passage of Scripture, but perhaps you're wondering, what does this have to say to us about the role and responsibility that God has given those of us who are fathers? My answer is three very important things. For you see, within these verses, we're given three specific insights into Joshua's life that assure us of his understanding of the role that God had given him as a father. And so this is what I want us to look at in our time remaining. And so what are they? Well, I want you to notice, first of all, that Joshua acknowledged the responsibility of being the spiritual leader of the home rests upon the father. The responsibility of being the spiritual leader of the home rests upon the father. Notice what he says in verse 15. "If it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, then choose you this day whom you will serve." Now, when he said that, who was he talking to? All of the people of Israel? Men, women, children? No, he was specifically speaking to men, and in particular, he was talking about the heads of the families. Look back at verse 1. It says, "He gathered all the tribes of Israel to Shechem. He called for the elders of Israel, for their heads, for their judges, for their officers, and they presented themselves to God." In other words, he called together all the men who had the responsibility of being the heads of their families. And he said, because you are the heads of your family, the responsibility of spiritual leadership rests upon you. He said, "Men, it's up to you to lead your family in worship." Now notice, he did not say women. He did not say mothers. He said, "Fathers, it's your responsibility. You're the one who should be the spiritual leaders." And so he acknowledged that the home could never be all that God intended it to be until men understood their role as fathers. And, you know, as we look at our nation today, it's evident for all to see that the family as an institution is crumbling. It's being torn apart and destroyed. And it's easy for us to want to place the blame on the liberal government of the day, or these far left groups who are lobbying to legitimize alternative types of family. But rather than placing the blame there, I submit unto you that the main problem facing our nation today lies with those of us who are fathers, those of us who are husbands, who fail to assume the responsibility God has given to us as being spiritual leaders. Now, I know that there are a lot of men who will say, "Well, maybe I'm not the spiritual leader of my home, but I want you to know I'm a good father. I love my children. I provide for my children. I meet all of their physical and material needs." And that's an important part of being a father, but it's not the most important part. A man can be the best provider in the world, but unless he assumes a position of spiritual leadership that God's given him, his home can never be everything God wants it to be. You know, many a man has been successful in the eyes of the world and yet turned out to be a failure as a father. You know, again, one of the things that I admire most and love most about the Bible is that it always paints the correct portrait of the people that it tells us about. And some of the greatest men in all the Bible turned out to be failures as fathers. I mean, The Word of God describes Lot, the nephew of Abraham, as falling into that category. If you go to the New Testament, to the book of 2 Peter, the Word says he was a just and righteous man. In other words, he was able to live in the wickedness of Sodom and Gomorrah and yet still live a godly life. But because he failed to be the spiritual leader of his home, he lost his entire family. Three of his daughters refused to leave the cities because of their relationship with the world. And when God rained down fire and brimstone upon those cities, they perished with all the other ungodly people. He lost his wife because she refused to obey the clear word of the angel of the Lord when he told her not to look back, but because she had such an attraction for that. She had to have one last look, and when she did, she turned into a pillar of salt. And then finally, the two daughters that did leave the city with him had such little respect for their father that they got him drunk all night, and one after the other laid with him and ended up being with child of your own father. What a tragic ending for this man. And though he himself may have been righteous, he failed as a father. And you know, you can go through and see many, many other examples. David, Eli, case after case, example after example given in the Word of God for our admonition and learning. And how I pray that we would heed these admonitions. Because again, it's not enough just to be successful in the eyes of the world unless we lead our families in the way of God. We'll end up as failures also. And so he says to them, to you is given the responsibility of being the spiritual leader of your home. Then the second thing, not only did he acknowledge this responsibility, he also indicated the plan for the spiritual life of his family. He indicated the spiritual plan for them. At the end of verse 15, he said, but as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Now, I want to submit to you that that is a tremendous statement of faith. I mean, it's one thing for us to say, as for me, I'm going to serve the Lord, but it's an entirely different thing to be able to say my entire family is going to serve the Lord. What a wonderful thing to be able to claim all of your family for Jesus Christ. But I'm going to tell you, I think it goes deeper than just an exterior statement of faith. I believe that there was a foundation upon which Joshua could lay such a claim. See, when he made this statement, Joshua was 110 years old. In other words, serving the Lord was a way of life for this man. And I believe because of the spiritual leadership he had shown, serving the Lord was a way of life for his family. And I think what he was really saying was, listen, I don't know about the rest of you men, but as for me and my house, we're going to continue to serve the Lord. Not a day will go by that we don't take time out of the busy activity of life to worship Jesus Christ. And I want to say, if we're going to be the kind of fathers that God intends us to be, it's not enough just for us to lead our family in worship on Sunday. This is to be an everyday way of life. And I know that with all of the activities of the world today, this is a difficult thing. But if we're going to become the kind of father God intends us, it's essential. It's absolutely essential. Nothing must take away from that. That's the second thing that I wanted you to see. And then the third and final word is this. Not only do we see the responsibility that Joshua acknowledged and the plan that he indicated, but we see the determination that he made. The determination that he made. See, he determined in his heart that no matter what the rest of the nation did, he and his family were going to serve the Lord. Look again at verse 15. If it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom you'll serve, Whether the gods your fathers served that were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell, as for me and my house, we'll serve the Lord. See, what he was saying was, you do whatever you want to do. If you want to serve the gods your fathers served on the other side of the flood, go right ahead. If you want to serve the gods of the Amorites in whose land you live, that's your choice. But as for me and my family, we're going to serve the Lord regardless of whether anyone else does or not. Now, you know why Joshua would say that and say it with such assurance? Because he knew that God was faithful. Listen, this wasn't the first time that he'd had to stand apart from the crowd. 65 years earlier, at a little place called Kadesh Barnea, he had had to stand apart from the rest of the people of Israel. Of course, you know the story. Moses had sent the 12 spies in to spy out the land of Canaan. And when they returned, they were to give a report. And so the people came together with Moses, and these 10 spies said, listen, it's a good land, all right. It's everything that God said it would be. We've even brought forth some of the fruit to show you. But they said, we can't go in. Because, you see, the cities are walled. They're impregnable. And on top of all that, they're giants in that land. And we look as though we're grasshoppers in their sight. No, as good as it is, we can't go in. But it was then that two men, Joshua and Caleb, stood up and said, folks, listen, if we'll just trust the Lord, he'll give us the land. These people may be big, but our God is bigger than any of them. Just trust the Lord, and he'll give you the victory. And do you remember what the Bible says the people wanted to do to Joshua and Caleb? They wanted to stone them. And I'll tell you, things haven't really changed. I mean, whenever a man is willing to stand up for the truth of God's word, he had better be ready, because the world's going to come against him. I think about people today who are standing up against the homosexual agenda, against all of this gender nonsense. They're not only being sued, they're being called what? Terrorists. If you stand for God today, you better watch out. And it's only going to get worse. But if you're going to be the kind of man God calls you to be, then along with Joshua, you're going to say, I don't care what anyone else in this country does, I'm going to stay true to God's word. Now, in closing, let me ask you a question. When the years have gone by, and you're dead and gone, how are your children going to remember you? Just that you were a good provider who met all of their physical material needs. I hope that we'll not be satisfied with that. More than anything else, our children should be able to say, here was a man who loved the Lord and who led his family to the Lord. Because when it's all said and done, that's all that matters. That's all that's going to count, what we have done with role and responsibility that God has given us. You bow with me. Our Father in heaven, we do thank you. Lord, for this day, we thank you, Lord, for each and every father that's here. Lord, I pray that you'd place it upon our hearts to be all that you call us to be. Lord, we may have failed in the past, but this is a new day. Lord, we can start over. Lord, it's not too late. Just speak to the hearts of your people today. Lord, we give this invitation time to you. You use it. And we'll praise you in Jesus' name. Stand with me. Very appropriate invitation hymn. If the Lord would lead you to make a decision this morning, you come as we sing.
The Savior is waiting to enter your heart.
Anyone, will you come?
Why don't you let him come in?